Hello and welcome to our worship service today on this Transfiguration Sunday, the last Sunday before Lent. In compliance with provincial public health orders, the church is closed to in-person worship and gatherings. However, we as the church are still doing God's work in our community. For pastoral care or for more information, please see our website or contact the church office at 613-345-5014 or send us an email at firstkirk@truespeed.ca. Phone calls, messages, and emails are being monitored and returned. We also encourage you to share the YouTube links for these worship services with your family and friends. You may find them on our social media accounts and on the church website. You just type in First Presbyterian Church, Brockville, Ontario into Google or into Facebook and you will find us. And an online order of worship for this service is also available on our church website. Some announcements I'd like to call to your attention. Preparations are underway for the annual meeting of the congregation, which is currently scheduled for March 7th. Reports from the different groups, committees, and organizations are needed for the 2020 annual report. Please send reports to the church office as soon as possible. The next issue of the Challenge newsletter will also be coming up in mid-March. So, do you have stories, pictures, jokes, or updates to share? Please forward them to the church office by email, by mail, or drop them off at the church office for the editor's attention. The Presbyterians Read Lenten Book Study will begin on Wednesday, February 17th at 11 a.m. on Zoom for now. We are studying Into the Passion of Christ by Amy Jill Levine. Some people in the congregation are also doing the book study on their own, so that's an option if you're not comfortable joining in on Zoom. The books have been ordered, so if you are interested in taking part, please contact the church office. Depending on provincial health mandates and the guidance of the session, we may be able to have some of the sessions in person, physically distanced, wearing masks, later in Lent. Denise Kent, our Christian Education Coordinator, is busily putting together church school lessons and crafts to mail to our children, as well as Lent in a bag for church families. If you know of a child that might like to receive mail from us, please contact the church office and let them know. On this Transfiguration Sunday, as Jesus reveals to us who he really is, let us come to God in worship and thanksgiving for the gift of love in Christ. Let us join together in our responsive call to worship, which you will find on the screen in front of you, or also in our online order of service. Let us read responsively. God said, "Let light shine in the darkness. Lord, shine your light into our lives. We see the glory of God in the face of Christ. The light of Christ is with us day by day. Let us follow the light of Christ together. Let us worship God with thanks and praise." Our opening hymn, if you have a hymn book, is number 314, God is Love, Come Heaven Adoring. However, the words are also in the online order of service and on the screen in front of you. So feel free to follow along and sing with us.
Come creation, voices
And now I invite you to join with me in our opening prayer. Again, it will be responsive and the words will be in the order of service online or on the screen in front of you. Let us read responsively. God of grace and glory, to this worried world you reveal your presence in radiant glory and in gentle whispers. On mountaintops and in shadowed valleys, in classrooms and hospital beds, in homes and churches, in the quiet of nature and on busy streets. Yours is the presence that pushes past our fear to calm us. Yours is the love that transforms our doubt with reassurance. We come today to dwell in your goodness and offer you the praise you deserve. Amen. And now I'd invite you to continue with me as we say our confession of sin together. Holy God, along with our praise, we come to offer you our confession. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that many things keep us from trusting fully in your love. We are often distracted by our own desires and disappointments. We cling to anger and resentment. We fear for the future rather than seek signs of hope. Forgive us. Shine your love upon us so that your glory may be seen in us, and give us courage to follow Jesus wherever he leads. For we pray in his name. Amen. The Gospel of John records that God is love and that God's perfect love casts out fear. Friends, we are promised that those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Claim God's forgiveness in this good news. God's perfect love lives in you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now I'd like to invite the children to come join me at the Gospel Box. Let's see what we have in here today. Well, first of all, before we open the box, I have a question for you. What day is today? Well, I know it's Sunday, but it's Valentine's Day, right? So let's see what we have in the box that might be for Valentine's Day. Let's see. This is a day, of course, when we tell people we love them. So how might we tell them we love them? Well, in the Gospel Box, let's see, there's a card. It has lots of hearts on it. Says for someone special on Valentine's Day. So we might send them a card. You might give that to, say, somebody in your family. Or you might give someone a box of heart-shaped chocolates. Or if you really like somebody, you might send them something like this, a sparkly pillow that changes. It's very cool, isn't it? Or, let's see. You might give somebody something like this. It's one of these candies that has words on it and says, I woof you. So it's kind of cute. It's chocolate too. And no, I'm not going to eat all this chocolate. Don't worry. Well, in our Bible story today, we're going to hear about how much God loves us. And the story's like this. One day, Jesus took his friends Peter and James and John high up in the mountains, so that they could be alone. While they were on the mountaintop, Jesus' appearance changed. His clothes became whiter than this, our pulpit or pulpit falls here, or our communion table runner, or even my stool. Then a cloud passed over them and covered them, and from the cloud came a voice saying, "This is my son, and I love him." It was then that Jesus' disciples really knew who he was, God's son. And you know, God sent his son to us. I think that's the best Valentine we could ever ask for. Because in Jesus, God is saying, I love you, and you are mine. In Jesus, that we're reminded that we're all part of God's big family, and that God loves us and he will never leave us. Now, if you had some of this candy, like I have here, like this candy and this candy, So would you keep all this candy for yourself? You might get sick if you ate it all. I don't know. I would. I bet you would like to, but I don't think your family would let you. And it's the same with God's love. God doesn't want you to keep God's love all to yourself. No, God wants you to share it with other people. So as you celebrate Valentine's Day today, let's remember God's love for us. And let's think of ways that we can share that love with others around us, okay? So let's pray. Loving God, on this Valentine's Day, we give thanks for all the love you give to us today and every day. Help us share that love with other people through our kindness and care for others. Amen. So I might share some of this candy with Kathleen later on. Does that sound good? In the meantime, I'm going to put it back in the gospel box. And now let us bow our heads so we can pray together for insight into God's word for us this morning. Holy One, all wisdom comes from you. Guide us now as we hear your scriptures read and interpreted. May your Spirit help us to understand your word more fully and be transformed and transfigured to live it out. Amen. I'd now like to invite our scripture reader to come forward, Linda Osmond, and she'll be reading us our psalm and our scripture lesson for today.
The responsive psalm today is Psalm 50, verses 1 to 6. The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes and does not keep silence,
before whom is a devouring fire,
around whom is a mighty storm. God calls to the heavens above and to the earth, that the peoples may be judged. Gather to me my faithful ones, who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. The heavens declare God's righteousness. For God alone is judge. The scripture reading this morning is from Mark 9, verses 2 to 9. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud. "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God within us, for the word of God around us, thanks be to God.
Darkness shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Bless, be replaced. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence, from the shadows into your radiance. By your blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Fill Spirit, place. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. As we gaze on your kingly brightness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine.
God of light, fill us with your light as we hear your word today. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This week's text is a leap forward in the chronology of Mark's gospel. As we heard in previous passages, earlier, when we were talking about these over the last few Sundays, Jesus was baptized. Then, following his time in the desert, he began to preach and teach and heal as part of his ministry to announce the good news. Now, day in and day out, he would have walked through small, dusty villages, healing people whose lives had been blighted by illness or physical challenges, feeding the hungry and the lost, and facing issues with the temple elites. And as I was reading through these stories in preparation for today's message, I often thought to myself, this is so much work for Jesus. There are so many demands on him. Things are so uncertain. He doesn't know what's going to happen from day to day. So why does he bother? Well, then we have our story today that Linda read for us. Jesus takes three of his closest disciples and he climbs up a high mountain. And it is on that mountain he reveals who he really is. He shows his disciples that he's more than just an itinerant human rabbi and preacher, more than just a carpenter, a peasant from Nazareth. He reveals that he is the Son of Man. He hangs out with the greatest prophets and leaders in the Old Testament, Moses and Elijah. And a voice, whom we know as God, says to Jesus' disciples, "This is my Son, whom I love. Listen to him." This is what I think that any of us who were there would call a mountaintop experience. And I think it's fair to say that we've all had that kind of experience in our lives, right? Experiences when we feel like, well, we're just on top of the world. Maybe when you got married and had a child. Maybe when you got that big promotion at work. Perhaps when you won a contest or a competition. Or maybe when you confessed your faith in Jesus Christ. There are so many of these experiences in our lives. And when they happen, don't you wish they would last forever? But inevitably, you have to come back down the mountain and into the valley. The grind, the complexity, the burdens of daily living. And in these last 11 months or so, as we've been living through this pandemic, it's become even more complex and messy. For some of you out there, there's been pain and grief and suffering that threatens to overwhelm you, hasn't there? And you especially, and really all of us, could use a mountaintop experience. Something to lift and encourage us. Well, there's a little verse in our text today that I want to highlight. The writer of the Gospel of Mark has described Jesus' trek up the mountain with Peter, James, and John after trying to capture the awe-inspiring appearance of Moses and Elijah, after reporting the interruption and the instruction of that divine voice. After all this, in the last verse today, the writer of the Gospel of Mark simply reports, "As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead." Now, what I think is so significant about this little verse, and really it's so easy to overlook in the larger context of the story, is simply that it reports that after all that went on the mountaintop, Jesus came back down. Down to where the rest of his disciples were, down to where we are, down to the challenges of life here below. Down to the problems and the discomforts and the difficulties that are part and parcel of our life in this world. Down, if you read closely, to the crucifixion, because Jesus orders them not to tell anyone until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Now, of course, resurrection is a hopeful note, but it doesn't just imply, but pretty much necessitates that Jesus has to die first. Jesus came down. He didn't just go up into the mountains of revelation or inspiration, but he came back down again. Now, Jesus could have stayed on the mountain. He could have stayed bathed in glory. He could have conversed with Moses and Elijah. He could have just actually gone back to heaven with them and left the future of pain and suffering and death he knew was ahead of them. He could have just left that behind. So you might ask yourself, well, why didn't he? This, I think, is the key to understanding the heart of the Christian faith. God in Christ loves us, screwed up as we are, so much that God came down to be with us and for us, to take on our human life and our lot so that we might not simply persist, but flourish. Not simply have life, but have it abundantly. That we might understand that the God who created and still sustains the vast universe not only knows that we exist, but cares. God cares about our ups and downs, cares about our hopes and disappointments, cares about our dreams and despair, cares about all the things that we care about. God promises to be with us, to walk alongside us, to never, ever let us go, and in time, to redeem us and bring us into the company of saints, to life eternal. And that, finally, gives me something to tell all of you. And you can tell your family, your friends, your loved ones, your neighbors, and more. You are never alone. God in Jesus sees you as worthwhile, as worthy of love and dignity and respect. That God intends to use your gifts, and yes, you have gifts, to care for each other and for the world. That God loves you and loves your neighbor as well. That God will not give up on you, ever. Because Jesus came down for us. In love and in good. And on this Transfiguration and Valentine Sunday, that is the mountaintop experience and the best love letter ever. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, as we come to you on this day of love and light, remind us of your love and care for us as expressed through your word made flesh and through your written and spoken word for us today. Through the work of your Spirit, may we see you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly. Amen. Our next hymn, again, if you have a hymn book, one of our hymn books, it's number 187. But again, the words are on the screen in front of you and in the online order of service. It's "We Have Come at Christ's Own Bidding."
Yeah.
our prayers for the people today are responsive. So where I say, God in your mercy, please respond with, hear our prayer. So God in your mercy, you respond, hear our prayer. Let us come to God now with our prayers, knowing that the God who loves us so much is always ready to listen. Let us pray. God of life, God of love, you created us and set us in relationship with each other, in families and neighborhoods, communities and countries, cultures and nations. We give you thanks for all the supportive relationships which bring meaning and encouragement to our lives and have meant so much in times of isolation. Help us contribute what we can to sustain the well-being of our community for all who call it home. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of our faith and our future, there are so many pressures on homes and families today. Draw near to those who are struggling in economic difficulty and those burdened by the challenges to health and happiness this winter. Work with parents and children, married partners and next-door neighbors who face conflict in their relationships to create solutions that express mutual respect and resolve tension. Help this congregation support families, whatever their size or situation, as well as people living on their own to know your love. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of mercy and forgiveness, you call us to live together in peace and unity. We pray for our neighbors, our neighborhood, our community, and our nation. Where people are divided and bitterness turns into resentment, show us how to work for reconciliation. As the pandemic stretches on, we pray for all those whose skill and dedication is needed to support our common life. Wherever we can, may we offer words of encouragement and appreciation so others know how much they matter to you and to us all. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Today, we give thanks for our church family and for the years of worship and witness that has been offered here. So much has changed for us over these past months, and we pray that you will bless our leaders who have had to think carefully and creatively to encourage, nurture, and sustain our congregational life. And we remember those of our number in need of your special attention today in a moment of silence. Guide us all with your wisdom and insight, so we find ways to reach out to each other in support and friendship. Open our eyes to opportunities to reach out beyond our own fellowship as agents of your healing and hope. For we offer ourselves to you in the name of the transfigured Jesus, in the words that he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This Valentine's Day reminds us of the transforming power love has in many lives. Gifts we offer to God from the heart also transform lives of those around us. Let your offering today express your love for God and God's love for the world in Christ Jesus. The mission and ministries of our church are ongoing. You can give online through Canada Helps. Just type in First Presbyterian Church, Brockville, and it will come up. You may give by pre-authorized remittance if you sign up for that through the church office. That will be withdrawn from your bank account monthly. By e-transfer to firstkirk@truespeed.ca. You can use snail mail and mail your offering to First Presbyterian Church, 10 Church Street, Box 885, Brockville, K6V, 5W1, or if you live in the neighborhood, you may deliver your offering envelope through the mail slot in the door, red door on Church Street, and the envelopes are collected regularly. So come, let us bless our offering by singing the doxology.
Praise God from whom
let us pray. God of life and love, receive these offerings as our gifts and tokens of our love. Bless them so that they strengthen the ministries of love we undertake in Jesus' name. May our lives shine with hope in these difficult days of wintertime as we wait for healing and renewal through Christ our Lord. Amen. And our closing hymn is number 371 in the Navy Blue Hymn Book, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. If you don't have the hymn book, again, the words are on the screen in front of you or in our online order of service.
Awesome.
And now may God send us back down the mountain of our worship. We have changed. We cannot be silent anymore. We have seen the light of the world, so go and share the radiance of love, and may the brightness of God light our way. May the brightness of Christ shine within us, and may the brightness of God's Spirit flow through us today and always. Amen.